Hey everybody, what's going on and welcome to the video. And as always, before we get started today, I'd just like to take a quick moment to welcome all my new subscribers and to thank everybody who's been leaving me comments and messages down below. Guys, seriously, the amount of growth this channel has gone through has gone beyond my wildest expectations. So everybody here who's helped me get to this point, I could not do it without you, so I just have to take a quick moment to thank all of you. And anybody who is new here, please smash that like button and please subscribe to my channel. It really, really helps out a lot. All right, everybody. Well, hey, y'all keep doing what you do. Y'all are amazing. Thank you all so much. All right, let's get into today's topic.
In today's video, we're going to be talking about one of the most brutal topics when discussing the sinking of the Titanic. And it's not the sinking of the ship itself or what happened to the people on board while it was sinking. But instead, we're going to talk about what happened to the poor 1,500 souls that ended up in the freezing cold Atlantic after the Titanic sank from under them.
You see, it wasn't the threat of drowning that was the biggest, like, cause for concern for the Titanic's passengers and crew who were unfortunate enough to not find a lifeboat. You see, what happened to them? The biggest threat that night was due to cold. You see, the ocean around the Titanic was 28 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, let that sink in. 28 degrees Fahrenheit. If it would have been fresh water, it would have been solid ice. But where it was salt water, it was still a liquid. So just imagine your entire body diving into freezing cold water. Second Officer Charles Lyotaler described as soon as he made contact with the water, because he never left the ship, he said that when he made contact with that water, it was like 1,000 knives stabbing him all over his body all at once. Now, I turned to On a Sea of Glass, and what this book said, it has a chart in it that is called Nearly Unsurvivable. I don't know if you can see that very clearly, but it has a chart in it that describes the temperature for how long you could survive in water of that cold. In water, 32 degrees Fahrenheit or under, you've got less than 15 minutes of survival time in water that cold.
And you see, for most people, this was a best case scenario. There were some people on the Titanic who immediately upon making contact with this icy cold water, they went into cardiac arrest almost immediately. You see, just the sheer shock of making contact with this freezing cold water can have a huge effect on somebody's mental state. And for the rest of the people who were actually still able to keep their wits about them, they were just struggling for life, trying to figure out how to get out of this water while the ocean was slowly draining the life from them.
Now, you see, that 15-minute lifespan that I told you, you see, that's only based off the assumption that either A, you've got a life jacket on, or B, you found something to hang on to or float on while you're in that water. You see, if you were unfortunate enough to not have a life jacket or find something to cling to, your chances of survival were much less. So just imagine you're trying to find something, a lifeboat, or try to figure out what you're going to do, and you're swimming around in the ocean. Well, one of the main things that happens to you when you're in freezing water or just cold in general is something called hypothermia. And when your body gets cold and hypothermia sets in, your body goes into survival mode, and it wants to protect your heart, your brain, you know, your vital organs. So what it does is it redirects blood flow from your arms and legs in order to try to keep your vital systems working. Now, what that means is if you're trying to swim, you'll slowly begin to lose feeling in your arms and legs, basically them going numb. So after a certain point, you won't be able to swim anymore, and you'll just drown from the cold. You'll lose all of your strength so fast. It doesn't matter how physically fit or strong you are. And water that cold, if you don't have something to hang on to, you have a very, very good chance of just drowning.
And another thing you need to keep in mind is remember, there was no moon that night. So after the Titanic went down and all the lights disappeared, all these people that were now fighting for life in the ocean, they were doing so in pure, total darkness. It was as dark as you could possibly imagine while they were struggling for life in the freezing cold Atlantic Sea. And you see, for the 700 people that were actually in lifeboats, even though they weren't dying from cold, they were going through their own version of hell. They had to listen to the screams of 1,500 people who were struggling for life in the water.
Now, among several lifeboats, the people on board had discussed whether or not to go back and try to rescue some people in the water once the ship had went down. However, most boats decided against this. You see, the biggest reason was they were afraid that these 1,500 people in the water fighting for their lives, screaming for help, if they went in their lifeboats to try to pick some of these people up, their boat could easily be swamped or they could become victims themselves. I mean, you gotta think about it. You've got all these people in a panic trying to get out of the water. If your one lifeboat goes back into the crowd and tries to pick up a few people, your boat could easily be pulled under by all the people fighting to get into your boat. I mean, you could get capsized, your boat could get swamped with water. I mean, there's 1,000 ways that you could become a victim by going in to try to save the people in the water. So, I mean, I can't even imagine what it must have been like for the people in the lifeboats having to listen to the screams and cries of the 1,500 people in the water, knowing that there was nothing you could do to save them.
And within a half hour or so after the Titanic had disappeared, a lot of the screams and sounds of people in the water began to die away, as the people who were struggling for life in the water slowly began to succumb to the freezing cold conditions in the water that night. Around 3 a.m., Officer Lowe, who was in charge of one of the lifeboats, he decided that he wanted to go back and rescue people in the water after the Titanic had went down. So he organized several lifeboats and got them together and transferred as many people as he could from his lifeboat into another lifeboat, so he could have as many open seats as possible in order to try to go back and rescue some people in the freezing water.
Now, Officer Lowe did want to return to the Titanic's wreck site and rescue people in the water almost immediately after the ship went down. But just like everybody else, he decided as well that it was too risky. He knew that if he would have went into that mob of 1,500, his lifeboat would have been swamped by all the people in the water. So he did decide to go back, but he decided to wait a little while. He wanted to wait until things calmed down, which, you know, as we all know what that means, he wanted to wait until, you know, a lot of people had passed on and then try to rescue some of the people who were left. I mean, that sounds horrible for me to say it, but that was the truth. You know, I mean, I can't imagine having to think like that, you know, to try to think we have to wait until a lot of these people die. That way we can go back and try to rescue the few that are left. Because if they just tried to go in immediately, there's a very, very good chance that the rescuers would have died as well.
Around 3:30, 3:40 a.m., one lifeboat that was commanded by Officer Lowe did return to the site at which the Titanic had sunk in order to try to rescue survivors. However, at this point, there was basically no survivors left to be rescued. You see, as I said earlier, the average life expectancy in water this cold was 15 minutes. But remember, the Titanic sunk at 2:20, so it had been over an hour since the Titanic had sunk before this lifeboat returned to the scene. So at this point, they basically only had a sea of dead bodies waiting for them when they finally returned in order to try to rescue survivors.
Now, there is one thing that I need to point out that is very, very misleading about the James Cameron movie and that scene you just saw. When the lifeboat returned to Titanic's wreck site, they didn't have any flashlights. In fact, none of the lifeboats had flashlights throughout the entire course of the evening. The only lights that the people in the lifeboats had were either A, flares that the officers carried, emergency flares, or B, starlight. So that meant that some of the officers did use flares in order to organize and bring the lifeboats together. But when Officer Lowe went back into the Titanic's debris field, they only had starlight to guide them, and they tried to use sound to listen for survivors. Now, when Officer Lowe's boat did actually return to Titanic's wreck site, they did find two survivors pretty quickly. But one survivor did die briefly after being taken aboard the lifeboat. And they did find another survivor that was actually keeping himself up on some wreckage. But it took them a half hour to get over to him, even though he was around 20 yards or so away, because they had to navigate through all these bodies. Now, right before they left, they did actually encounter one more survivor. And it was a man who was on board the Titanic. And believe it or not, he was actually from China.
Right before Officer Lowe and his crew concluded their search for Titanic survivors, they heard a man yell out for them in Chinese to come and rescue him. His name was Fang Lang, and he was actually on board the Titanic, and he was originally from the country of China.
You see, Fang Lang actually turned out to be one of the luckiest people to be rescued from Titanic's debris field that night. You see, what he did was he did the most important thing you can do in order to try to survive in water that cold, and that is get out of the water. He happened to find a very, very long table and was able to balance himself on that table, meaning he was standing on his arms and legs, like, you know, balancing himself, keeping himself stable, just like in that shot you just saw. See, in water that temperature, you have to get out. You just have to get out of that water. And because he balanced himself like that, he was able to keep most of his body out of the water. So his hands and legs were pretty frozen, but, you know, his chest, his heart, you know, all of his vital organs were fine. So see, that's how he was able to survive. And when he did get picked up, he was in shockingly good condition. He rested for a little bit, got warmed up, and then he picked up an oar and started rowing to help the other crew get the lifeboat to safety. I mean, he was a vital, vital member of that lifeboat that night. After Officer Lowe and the crew picked up Fang Lang and were looking for other survivors, no one else could be found. They searched for a little bit longer, but then that was it. So after they rescued Fang Lang, there was no one else that they picked up that night. So in total, that meant that they found 3 survivors, and of which 1 passed away in the lifeboat. So that meant they only pulled 2 people out of the debris field. So I want you to let that number sink in. 1,500 people went into the sea when Titanic went down. And about an hour or so later, when they went back to find the people, only 2 survivors came out of there. I mean, that's just an unbelievable number. It's almost unimaginable to think about that. Now, I'm not including people who made it onto the last 2 lifeboats, Collapsible A and B. I'm going to cover those at some point. One of those lifeboats ended up capsizing, and there were a lot of people on that lifeboat who did survive. I'm not including them. The only thing I'm including in this are the actual people who were in the water, in the actual debris field, from when Titanic went down. I'll make another video covering Collapsible A and B at another point. Those were the 2 worst lifeboats to be in after the Titanic went down. Anyway, guys, that's it for this video. Thank you all so much for watching. And I know this video was a pretty rough video to watch. I mean, this is one of the most difficult things to talk about when it comes to the Titanic disaster, is what actually happened to the people who were there that night. You know, we can all be fascinated with the ship and the science and everything that happened to it while it was going down. But when you sit there and you actually think about what happened to these people, I mean, it's very hard to think about what these people went through and the horror that they experienced the night the Titanic sank. Anyway, guys, that's it for this video. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't done it already, and please give this video a like. It really, really helps out a lot with the YouTube algorithm. And yeah, all right, everybody. Well, hey, you all stay safe out there, and the next video topic will be a little bit lighter, I promise. All right, everybody. Well, hey, you stay safe, and I'll see you in the next one.